in the cabbage.
Well, let's get it.
Test, test, test.
Yeah, we're live.
Welcome to In the Cabbage. This is crazy.
This is pretty bananas right now that we're actually doing this.
I'm Tommy Sway. Andrew Witt. Please subscribe. Please listen. Please download. Like. Just a reminder. Keep swinging. Heyo! Welcome back to In the Cabbage. I'm your boy, Tommy Swain.
T-Swizzle.
You know, it's how I be. To my right or your left, my best friend, Andrew Witt.
What's up?
What is up, buddy? Welcome back. Here we go again.
Yeah. What are we on now? Is this six?
Yeah, man. We just done so many episodes. I lose
track.
It
is like just a blur at this
six.
Point.
Six. I mean,
losing
it's crazy.
We're just losing out of things to talk about. Running out of things to talk about. Yeah, right.
Right. I think that's why we're going to be A-OK is because we never run out of things to talk about. Madison's always like, it's just impressive how.
Just keeps it rolling. Well, it's also, I mean, sports obviously keep rolling on and on, but we do have a lot of things that are moving in our lives. So, and speaking about things that are moving on in lives, you and Madison went on a little trip down to San Diego this past weekend. How was that, buddy?
I
didn't really get to talk to you about it.
Yeah, it was like a weekend getaway. We don't do it very often. And I have some tips and tricks to help maybe next time Madison and I talked about how to be more efficient with a weekend getaway.
For like budget wise or just time wise?
Yeah, I'm talking like a true weekend getaway, like one, two nights.
Yeah.
Not like, oh, I had three nights, you know. That's like a vacation.
You haven't sold Madison on a hostel yet?
I am close. She's a
really?
Big fan.
Really?
No, come on.
you got me there. You're
come
pretty.
On, my wife in a hostel?
You're pretty convincing.
Yeah, my wife. It's like, hey,
you know,
let's
go. There are like, if. I mean, we'd never do this, but I've seen it like where you can get like private rooms and like private sections.
I'm sure there's some nice hostels out there, but
not looking at any of them.
No,
I get it.
Yeah,
I get it. Okay, so yeah, money wise.
So
you got
to
look at a couple
other things.
There
were some cool parts of this trip we wanted to do San Diego. One of it being, my dream was to have my dog on the golf course with me at some point.
Yeah.
That's
fantastic.
I saw a video from RGC.
Yeah, I was just about to say, shout out Eric Anders for that.
One of our guys who's inspired us to do this. He went to Scotland, saw a bunch of dogs like running around, and I thought, wow, that's like the dream to be like 50 years old, living in Scotland, and having your dogs just like run with you while
for
you
sure.
play golf.
And that's another cool thing too. He has a lot of his videos where he goes and like essentially. You know, takes like a little bit of a background check on some of these courses and does extended filming about the course, history, blah, blah, blah. But a lot of the greenskeepers have dogs with them.
Right.
And I just think that's such a cool vibe. So
it's cool. I mean, in Scotland, too, golf isn't like fenced off and gated off and like no one can go on the property and no one. Well, yeah, are you playing golf? Where are you here for?
Yeah, you can literally walk out there.
It's like a park.
Yeah, it's crazy.
And I just think that's super cool. It's so different from what we're used
to. People riding their bikes, people taking walks.
Right. It's super cool. But so we actually played a course called Emerald Island. It's a dog track.
Yeah.
Like it's not, I mean, let me run that back, not so aggressively. It's a par three course.
Yeah.
It could be four from the tips, but the longest par three is like 205.
Okay.
So it's a par three course.
18 holes?
18 holes.
Nice.
We got through none, like five. I mean, it was slammed. That's part of the problem.
That's a bummer.
Yeah. Walked in there, super cool driving range, grass driving range, but awful grass. Still cool, though. Food looked great.
Did it have any mats? Is it talking about the grass just on the range?
No, yeah, it was just all grass, no mats.
Got it.
It's a small driving range. It's like within this, like, Oceanside in San Diego in general is just possibly the weirdest city ever built.
It's a little strange. It's got a lot of different sections.
A lot of different
of
characters to it.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like they all live on the cliffs. Is there any flat land in San Diego? Is it just on the ocean? Because if it's just on the ocean, everything else is on a cliff.
The parts that we visit, I guess, is basically always on the coastline.
Always?
Yeah.
Well, I'm up in, you know, Tujunga Canyon, or not Tujunga Canyon, but some, you know, weird canyon.
Yeah.
We're on a hill. And you drive down the bridge and you drive across the bridge to somewhere else that's on a hill. It's just not if it's flat ground, which is fine. It's just different. And where we stayed was super cool. But the golf course, food looked great. I bought a ball marker from there. The merch was cool. It was a really like hip, which is an awful word to describe something now. a really hip and cool vibe. It was a, you know, a really cool vibe.
Yeah.
For sure. It looked like they didn't care.
It just sounds like they're a very open course that's willing to just accept anyone.
Like dogs,
it's very welcoming. Right. It's just, it's pretty much with the way golf, we believe, should be going. Right.
First time I played in a t-shirt and like some pants.
That's really cool.
So
we were also, I mean, there's a couple of courses that are out there too. We were looking at one. It was that like mock par three course that was mimicking like the Masters. It's not open anymore, unfortunately.
Right.
But they're like, yeah, you can't even come in with like a college shirt. We're gonna like kind of kick you out. Like, we're not one of those clubs.
Right. And then, so it was a cool, cool vibe. It was, the starters were great and everything.
Nice.
So of course I'm just so nervous about Hendrix, like barking and being annoying, and
yeah,
like I'm on, you know, high alert 10, and I got wifey with me too. So she was just watching, so she was able to like handle Hendrix, which was like awesome.
Oh, she didn't play?
No.
Oh, gotcha.
It just was like how are we gonna like logically like figure that, like you hit while I hold Hendrix and I hit then you hold Hendrix, like
right.
It gets a little rough. And she didn't, we had to lug two sets of clubs down there. She hit my, you know, on the range, hit my 7-iron beautifully. She has such a good swing. I gotta show you it. It's so low and so perfect for like the modern day, like people who are trying to do golf swing. Mm. Like the club is below her shoulder the whole time.
Really?
And
just really shallow.
Really shallow. And she just, I mean, there was, she was on a, like, she was on
just
a,
gets it right down to the slot, right down in there.
And hit in the slot and, you know, repped out like 5-6 good 7-irons with my irons. So heavier, longer.
Found the golf prodigy of the family here.
Yeah, I mean, she's definitely here on the course. She definitely has better hand-eye than me, too. That's a lie. I would crush her in hand-eye coordination.
I was gonna say, you gotta give yourself a little credit there, bud.
But so we, you know, the course was cool. I worked that day was a bogey. Like par, bogey, par, bogey, or whatever.
This is where you got my number in golf games.
Yeah. I mean, in many aspects. The putting felt so much better.
It was the putting mat again, dude. We cannot stress that enough. We
How
came over here.
Feel? Okay, we'll get to that. But
yeah, keep rolling through your weekend.
I used the chipper every chance I got, and I dropped a wedge next to it, too, to see how different, do it differently.
Yeah.
Because it was so slow. We were waiting on three other people to come. They weren't at the tee box.
Were you paired up with another twosome?
We were supposed to be with three other people.
They let out fivesomes out there?
Well, Madison wasn't playing, so it was me and three others.
Got it. That makes sense.
Right. So,
keep forgetting about that.
You know, they didn't show up at the right time. So I'm like, can I just go? And she's like, yeah, just go. Which was a mistake, because ahead of us was like a baby who was playing, two young kids, a dad and a mom. They were slammed from like the people in front of them. They were playing as a fight.
Right.
It's just packed the whole way down. Waiting like,
oh, I mean, it's a par three course. You can expect that, and it's going to be busy. It's on the weekend.
It's
everyone's
like
getting into golf. You know, like
on each tee box.
That's a lot of time.
It took us like 45 to an hour to get through like 5 or 6 holes. And
you're
it was starting getting a little dangerous, because like the cart paths were all like one road. They were really close to each other. Tee boxes are getting backed up. It's a par three course. I'm not that accurate.
Yeah.
So, like, you kind of got to be accurate on this course, too. There's not much room to miss, like, anywhere.
Sounds like it's just tight. They're just trying to squeeze in 18 holes.
Yeah.
On a property.
Got a little dangerous. And I had a dog with me. I didn't feel like dealing with it. I played okay. But it was fun. Just fun to have the dog out. Like, you know, a couple holes, which was great. We were able to like let him go off the leash. He ran around. He like ran up to me. I gave him a golf ball. He ran back, gave it to Madison. He's jumping in and out of the golf cart.
That's really cool. When you can take the whole fam down there.
Yeah.
You don't have to, like, you know, Hendrix is going to come with us for the San Diego trip, and he's able to come out and play golf. We don't have to leave him someplace or whatever. It's kind of fun.
So, you know, I was more worried about him, which is totally taking me out of my, you know, present mind.
Of course. You got to worry about just golf balls flying all over the place.
I did a better job of it this time, just being like, I'm breathing. I'm not going to, like, worry about it. Like, there's other dogs walking on the course. There's babies crying. Like, my dog barking isn't going to kill anybody here.
Right.
So we played 5 holes, but we wanted to go to Heritage Barbecue. open up a new location.
And yeah, the amount of, I don't know, dude, just some anguish sending you, like, in my in my seat that I was like, you know, I saw that text come in. I'm like, wow, this man's getting Heritage Barbecue again.
Right. It's Madison and me love it. So it's great. It's not, it's an, such an easy sell for her.
Can you give a little backstory for the people that about Heritage Barbecue?
Yeah, so Barbecue? Heritage Barbecue is a the best barbecue in California, I'm going to call it. I don't think you're going to find better.
Yeah, because there's a reason for that.
Right, so the guy, here. This guy is from SoCal, the owner, I don't remember his name, my apologies, but he won a Michelin star this year, but he trained.
Did he?
Yeah, they won a Michelin star.
Wow.
Yeah, so they're a Michelin star barbecue place now.
That is impressive.
Yeah, it's super cool, especially in Orange County.
I don't know a lot of I don't know a lot of barbecue places that have Michelin stars. It's not a very...
Especially in California. Texas, they all have them.
Yeah.
They're dishing them out like candy out in Texas.
Out in our way. Yeah, of course. Okay.
So he's obsessed with barbecue. He's from SoCal. He went to Texas to learn how to do barbecue the way he wanted to do it. Brought that back to SoCal with SoCal flavors. So like you're getting a lot of like... weird, different, like, you're getting corn and, like, different...
brisket tacos I saw on the menu and that kind
of
stuff.
He's doing a lot of different flavors, like corn hatch chili, salsa, whatever. It's all different with the classic smoking. He has his brisket and all that stuff. So successful, he opened up a location in Oceanside that's a bar. And bar and smoke, like smoke place. So it has his breakfast, his brisket tacos. He has
that's
his
really cool
bamis. He's got like appetizers on there. So it's not just the barbecue.
Mm, gotcha.
And like, you know, a couple other sides. It was so fire. It takes forever because it's being smoked and it's a restaurant.
Right.
I got a cocktail, fire. Sat down. It's like a really good wood ranch.
Yeah,
like it's like a very diverse menu.
It's got to be better than that.
Well, I mean, yes, I'm saying diverse menu for barbecue.
I see what you're saying.
Like menu looks like a normal restaurant menu. It's not like I want brisket, a pound of this. You know, we got brisket and pork belly burnt ends.
Fire, I'm sure.
The best bomb. Potato salad I've ever had in my life.
Oof,
mac and cheese.
It's all right up your alley, right there.
What else did we get? We ended up like getting...
Cornbread?
No. We got... I forgot. We got something else. Oh, slaw. We tried to throw something healthy in there.
Do they do a vinegar base or they do
mayo base?
It was cream base.
Mayo cream. Yeah. It's good. It's not anything like crazy. I mean, slaw is pretty hard to do personally. But other than that, man, the Airbnb was okay for a last minute trip. San Diego was fun. We ended up leaving a day early. We were supposed to be there 2 days. The only thing we were going to do...
Left you there a day early?
Yeah, we went one night.
How come? Just wanted to get back or something? Or
kind of. So we did the first night. It was fun. Like around 6 or 7 o'clock, we were wiped.
Yeah.
We ended up taking like a 2-hour nap by accident. We both just like went back to the room. Woke up at like 6:45.
Mm.
And we're like, oh, okay, well, you know, we weren't really going to do anything anyways because our dog was with us. Where we were staying, there was nothing cool to walk around to. It's like a community.
Got it. So you were going to like go out and go
it was
somewhere
like
15 and do
minutes
it.
Away to downtown San Diego.
Oh, so you just drove back like that night?
Yeah. So we stayed that night, right? And then the owners were like upstairs or something, and the walls were paper thin.
Got it.
I could hear him like walking around the whole time. Like it was like not, like he was probably just trying to walk, and it sounded like he was coming through the ceiling. So that made us worry to leave Hendrix. The next day, we got there Saturday night. We were supposed to stay Sunday night as well. Mm-hmm. The next morning, we woke up and we're like, okay, what are we doing today? So we went on a hike.
Yeah. Nice. How was the hike?
Fire. But yeah. We got, so it's like this waterfall in San Diego. I forget the name of the area. But it's supposed to be like a waterfall at the end of it. And it's muddy the whole way through and parts of it. And it was such a beautiful hike. But the whole point of it is to go see this waterfall, right? It's like a 2-mile hike. We get to like...
Is it dried up?
No. We get to like almost entering to the waterfall portion of it, and it's closed down. But it's not like a fence and like really high insecurity. It's like 2 traffic cones with like yellow tape saying like, don't, it's closed.
So you went...
Classic me would be like, I'm going.
You're going.
I'm going.
Yeah, of course.
There's no way I'm not going.
What... Well, you're telling me 2 cones are going to stop me from walking on this path? Like, come on.
Yeah. but I got my wife with me. And Madison's a bit of a rule follower. heavy rule follower. So I look at her, and as soon as I see it, she won't even, like, walk closer to the cone. She stopped
playing. Might as well have just been a giant bear at the end of the trail.
Stopped, like, 20 yards short. She was like, yeah, we're not going. And I'm like,
what do you mean?
What do you mean? We're 100% walking around.
We're here. We came here to do the hike and see the waterfall.
There's
Let's
no way I'm
go.
Not seeing the hike. Like, no way I'm not seeing this waterfall.
Right.
And we were probably like a mile left into it, right? We probably walked a mile. We have one more mile left. And, I mean, there's no way. There was no convincing her. She's like, no, there's a reason why it's closed. There could be bobcats. There could be who knows. Like, we're not doing this. And instead of me being like, oh, I, you know, fight for this 1 mile. I'm like, you know what?
Yeah, it's fine.
Whatever. I just, like, I get home earlier, catch the end of the round live, so I don't have to, like, watch highlights or replays.
Yeah, it's all a good call. And I mean, there's all reasoning for everything.
Yeah, we talked that morning. We're like,
and, like,
would
the waterfall really have been that sick?
I don't know. He said it's not even really a waterfall. He said it's, like a falling stream. I've seen waterfalls in Oregon. Those are waterfalls.
Yeah, for sure.
So, anyways, like, we talked that morning. We're like, well, we're going to do a hike and dinner. So, like, Hendrix has to be alone by himself in this room. Dog's going to bark. The owner's upstairs.
So you're just like, let's just call it.
Yeah. After
so then
the
you
hike.
Drove back.
So we just went Sunday morning, hiked, and we just packed our car up and left.
Okay.
It was good, though. Played golf. It was super fun. I'm really excited for tomorrow. I'm playing Ike in L.A.
Yeah.
It's like supposed to be a tour course.
Is that Industry City?
Yeah, City of Industry. It's maybe where we're going to be joining our men's club next year. It's actually currently like 10 or 20 bucks more expensive than our current club with just as many tournaments, all cash payouts, and they have two full 18s. It's a hotel course, and they've hosted events.
And it's apparently, just looking at some of the pictures online, they just got a great practice facility. They look like they got a lot of good amenities to the place. 36 holes is a big factor as well.
Two full 18s. We're playing the championship course tomorrow.
That's cool.
Tip, so it's almost 7,000.
Whoa.
Yeah.
That's a few yards right there.
So it'll be fun to play. But I know, let me hear about your weekend. I know you played some golf. Oh, real quick. Sorry. We talked about possibly doing a new aiming for it.
Mm-hmm.
I did do some new aiming. I aimed in front of the ball. Didn't love it. I'm going to keep trying now. I'll give you an update. But
for people that are just tuning in now, first off, just go listen to the last episode and then subscribe. Right. But to give you
love
a little
that
bit. But to give
Make
a little,
that money.
But to get a little bit of a background, we watched a little bit of this guy about decade golf, shots gained, strokes gained, you know, how to play golf, blah, 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 based on statistics. You know, he's talking about how to aim correctly, and instead of aiming at something abstract and far away, picking a spot in line with that tree that you're picking on the horizon, giving yourself a little bit more concrete of an aiming point directly in your field of vision.
Right.
So did you like it or like, it was like it served its purpose or?
I love how you have to explain my shorthand. I love that for us.
You know, you bring up the topic and I just roll real quickly right into it.
I really love the thank you for explaining to people because I would have explained that and they would have been more confused than me just talking about it. They wouldn't picking up the pieces for themselves. Didn't love it. I was thinning a lot of shots, but you got to give it more practice.
When you're thinning shots, is it like thin, like sculling it or like catching it just a couple grooves low?
Like I'm hitting a pitching wedge. I normally hit 120. I'm hitting like 135.
Okay. That's not too bad, dude. You can learn how to control that a little bit.
Right. It was way lower. It just hit and skipped.
That's kind of nice.
Yeah. So I got to keep
I was
going to
say,
trying.
Dude, that's a shot that you can play actually.
Right. So it's something I got to keep trying. I can definitely feel myself getting more shallow, which was nice.
If you want to talk about keeping the ball low, that's what you should do, like as an escape route from trees. You can use that.
Yeah. I have to.
Or
I don't know if it's just mistakes. I have to keep trying to make sure that's like actually what the shot
is. I feel like you should keep
like
going for it. I unfortunately forgot, of course.
Right.
But like that's something that you can do, especially with into the wind shots. If this is something that just lowers your trajectory just a little bit anyways, like, you know, this could be something that you can use, you know, on certain shots, just like you like to play, you know, how much of a slice you're going to play. You just, that can control a little bit of your trajectory almost.
Totally.
And see how it works.
I would love to keep trying. I'll keep everyone updated.
Did you, I guess the whole point of it is, did you start the ball online, more online?
No.
Not really. It's kind of similar.
It kind of was getting a little erratic. Yeah. It like went over the green though. It didn't like you know, it was so still yeah, really greenish.
On. Okay.
So the little tips and tricks we're going to do for Madison and myself moving forward for these weekend getaways would be if it's 2 hours or less, like to San Diego, one night. Get down there early, do what you're going to do during the day, one night, do the next thing the next day,
yep.
Come home.
Yep.
As far as Palm Springs, I would say, because I just love Palm Springs, I'm doing two nights. But Palm Springs can also be just a one-night thing. So basically, if it's yeah. anything that's 2.5, 3 hours out, it's going to be two nights.
That makes a lot of sense. That's a good way of
doing it. If it's like an hour and a half to like two-ish, one night's fine.
Mm-hmm.
It just also depends where you're at. Some people love San Diego. I like it for sure. Just not my favorite.
It's a place that you've been to a whole bunch of times, though, as well. One night.
Right.
Just get a quick little getaway.
Now, if you're in Palm Springs, I got plenty of courses I can play out
there. Of course, of
course. San Diego, is everything so expensive, or it's like...
It makes it more difficult to do things, for sure. Plus, you've also been to San Diego a whole bunch. You know, how many new things are you really going to go and do and find, blah, blah, blah. You could just come back, go do that one thing after you do that. So,
But I want to hear, you played some Ben Brown this weekend. How'd you play, buddy?
Good, dude. But before we get into the golf...
Mm-hmm.
I actually downloaded Red Dead Redemption 2.
Oh,
and
really?
I am really late to the game. I understand it. I understand.
Love that.
I understand the game came out 6 years ago.
I've never played it.
I get it. So one of these topics that we were going into, and we can save this for another day, but I'll kind of give you a little bit of the backstory how I got here. Basically, I got into a conversation with people saying, "What is your favorite video game of all time?" And everyone was basically saying, the consensus was Red Dead Redemption 2.
Yeah, it's all time. Taylor Lewan on Bustin' with the Boys said he cried for days after the game was over.
Our buddy Chris said that it is a life-changing game, and it is like a movie, TV show, and it hits you in your feels.
Right.
And I was really shocked, because the only other video game that I've ever felt that before was BioShock.
Yeah. And this is going to show all over BioShock.
Potentially. I do love BioShock, dude.
I know. That's
it
your
gives you
sure.
your, not Interstellar, it gives your an Inception-like finish at the end of BioShock. It's alternate reality endings, which is crazy.
But you like the style of game, which Red Dead Redemption, that BioShocker.
I do like that style.
Yeah. More story-based, first person.
Definitely, definitely. It's a fun thing that Katie and I like to do. So we go and, last game I just played was the Zelda Breath of the Wild.
Mm-hmm.
My God, was that a fire game. That's my number two.
Yeah.
So
it's a great list you got going.
I am looking to dive into this Red Dead Redemption 2. I heard it's just an unbelievable game. Really looking forward to playing it and diving into it.
Updates. So
we, it's super sick.
Yeah.
For a game that came out that long ago, and I mean, I don't play that many video games right now. I'm in it for obviously just really good, just a really good storyline,
right.
Gameplay,
to
that
get
kind
you
of
through.
Stuff. Exactly. So I got through the first chapter. Super cool. Really dope premise. I feel like this would be a game you might get bored with, but at the same time, you could definitely dive into this because it's very much in like your realm of movie-like
totally.
Picture of like, you know, you like Western, you like mob movies and stuff like that. It's definitely in that realm of your liking.
Yeah, I get that.
It just you just lose interest with storylines like that too, huh?
Yeah, because I'd rather watch movies.
Yeah, and then you're also like kind of you end up fumbling around sometimes on those games.
I
you
also
know?
Just like to complete every side mission instead of just
too.
Getting through the story.
I
and
do
that
too.
Burns
it just,
me out.
It just consumes me.
Right.
Yeah, I know.
With first person shooters, I could just jump on, suck at it real quick, and get off.
So, yeah, it was really cool. It's a really dope game. I'll keep you updated on that.
Please.
But just wanted to bring that up there because that was a big part of our Friday night, actually. We just downloaded that game. It took like 3 days to download, dude. It was like over 100 gigabytes. It's crazy.
You got to delete other games on
I
your
did.
Xbox.
I did.
Make space.
I had to make a ton of space for that game.
Three
My
days,
God.
Dude.
Yeah. I mean, I wasn't doing it for all 3 days, all day, but it was a good 2-3 hour sessions.
Right. It's
on
also
each day.
Just a super old Xbox.
It is. It's a little old.
Yeah.
You know, it's also just a massive game. It's 100 gigs. It's
right.
It's a big file. So anyways, moving on from that, because that was basically Friday night. Saturday, we were just chilling, hanging out, doing a couple wedding things, blah, blah, blah. you know. And then Sunday went over to Ben Brown. It's now called The Ranch, actually, down in Laguna Beach. Fantastic little 9-hole golf course this is. For you guys that have not checked it out, it is 1,000% worth it. It is such a cool track. Par 3 course. They have par 4s. Longest hole, I think, is 300 yards. It's so narrow, though. It's just like you don't even need to take driver, and that's where I got in trouble a lot.
Yeah, the driver game needs to come out for you.
It does. And the course is too narrow. It punishes you too much. I don't have that much control over the driver for me. So it's just I should have left it in the bag, but stupidly I brought it out because I want to make the hero shot and drive it right up there in the front of the green. Right.
Just tap it in front of Chris and Court and Katie and let that thing swing a bit.
Exactly, because Chris is up there rolling it up 285 to the front edge, and I'm like, ooh, I can get this too. Mm-hmm. I'm right there as well. And of course, straight out of bounds.
Damn.
Obviously we teed off a little early. It was a little cold, whatever. First tee, dude, I putted it off the green today, or on Sunday as well when I went.
Yeah, how'd you putt?
Putting was fantastic once I got the speed down.
Wait, the course, it took me for the speed.
Yeah, the speed took me till I was like hole 5.
Right.
You know, I mean, like that's what it takes, but then at that point your round's over because it's only 9 it's only 9
right.
holes.
That putting mat, we wrapped it out a couple days ago for an hour, and my putting felt
That was fun.
It was better.
We even played a little game with it too, a little round the world action. It was really fun.
Right. It's a really fun game.
On the smaller hole as well, not the regular regulation size hold.
You can sit there, put some ESP on. But yeah, so you were wild. How many golf balls lost? What was the golf
ball
count?
It was like 4 in like 9 holes.
Wow, dude. I think I lost like 4 to 5 all Ryder Cup.
That is just my Achilles heel right there.
Wildness is really starting to show. I don't know if it's because, are you doing your new swing at all times?
Yeah, but when I'm... the problem is that I get away with it on my longer clubs. The longer the club gets for me, I'm realizing, the more trouble I get into with blocks. And I'm not drawing it anymore like I used to because of my new delivery. So my club path is inconsistent when I'm striking the ball, especially with the longer clubs, because it takes me a little bit more time to get around. Maybe I might have to feel like I'm swinging harder, which makes me like drop my hand super far inside. I get stuck and I just don't rotate and I just hit these massive blocks. So it's not like I'm hitting it really far wide on this course. I actually hit pretty good drives, probably about 30 yards right on my target.
Mm-hmm.
But 30 yards right on this course is in the trees. Right. It's
gone.
It's in the canyon. Yeah.
In the cabbage, which is just basically
which is brutal.
Right.
Which is brutal. And I got to hole number 5, and I took driver, which actually had a lot of space. But of course, I missed it on the wrong side where I'm not supposed to.
Right.
Great. Perfect.
Always
on
the wrong side.
And this one's white stake. So I go grab another ball. And I actually smartly put the driver away, grab hybrid, and then proceed to do the exact same thing and just yeet that thing off to the right canyon.
There's nothing worse than playing the smart shot and it's still going bad.
Demoralized.
Back, it's demoralizing. It's really, there's really nothing worse than like, okay,
I should have carded a 10 on that hole or 12. Honestly, I moved on from the white stake. I'm like, I'm not losing a third golf ball off this tee.
Right. Like, this hole will not take a third ball.
No, nor am I going back to the cart to grab another golf ball.
Is Katie chirping you at this point?
No, it was so bad. People were just quiet.
Okay, well, that's good.
Yeah.
No one was chirping you.
No, I'm giving myself a really hard time. Honestly, I'm letting myself have it at this point.
Yeah, you know.
Followed up with a good wedge shot, but you know, that's the bad part of my game. It truly is anything 6-7 iron and longer. I really get those blocks that happen that shoot out. I don't really get that with any other club less than that. So
yeah, it's weird. So just I think we gotta get you to the range and just start repping it out a bit more.
It's for sure my tempo of my swing and like my timing, my feel. When you say like everything is looking in sync, mm-hmm. that's what I'm starting to line things up and then everything is kind of coming together. It just doesn't quite feel in sync with my longer clubs right now. And so just repping it out a little bit.
Yeah, just some reps I think will really help.
For sure. I wonder if it also maybe if you we joke about it a lot, but it is a factor for me. the colder weather does make me block a ton of shots.
Yeah, you are. Once this gets warmer here for you at some point, you're going to be all-star Andrew Witt again.
Just, I don't know what it is, dude. It's just the weather. I just feel more free when I can swing.
You'd rather it be like 105 than 62.
52.
52 is too cold?
Yeah. 62 is okay.
I've heard you complain at 62.
I 100% will, but when you're putting it up against 105, I'm going to take 62.
105 with a breeze? Cloudy? Yeah.
I mean, I could do that. Easily. I'd much rather have that than 60 degrees. Let's put it that way.
Okay. That makes sense.
If we're now going cloudy and a little breezy at 60 degrees, want none of that.
I don't want wind in general when I swing a golf club.
No, but especially when it's cold. But yeah, maybe that has something to do with it because I tend to always play my better golf later in the year anyways.
Yeah.
Like come June, July, August when like the game we've been practicing and playing a little bit more for sure. I'm sure that's because of it, but I think a lot of it is also because of the weather. But putted great. You know, just rock solid with the flat stick once everything was going well. I did put it off the green because the greens were so fast.
Yeah.
I had a putt for 30 feet, but it was just downhill, and I just hit it 6 feet past, and then there was a drop off the front.
You're like, see you, ball.
It was devastating. But I managed to save my bogey from there, went up and down. Just played this low skipper right at the hill, stopped to like 3 feet.
Oh,
classic,
whip.
Classic me.
Classic whip. How did Chris buy? I know he got that new Scotty Cameron in Newport.
Dude, he was rolling it so well, playing fantastic. He was 200 through three, actually.
Same grip and everything?
On the putter?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, same grip. I think he bought it used. I don't know if it was new. I'm not too sure.
Okay.
I didn't really ask him a ton of questions about it. It's just Scotty looked like it was in great shape. It was fantastic, but I don't know. I don't know if it was like one of their new designs. Yeah, I'm not sure
like
where they're
new
at.
New grip, not like new.
It's got the same Scotty grip.
No. Chris's grip wasn't new.
Yeah, it's got the same Scotty grip on like, it. Scotty Cameron. Like Scotty Cameron grip?
Yeah. But like the way he's gripping the club, he grips like overlapping. He grips the club weird.
Oh, sorry. His hands.
Yeah, his hands grip. Not the club grip.
Yeah.
Classic. The club, his
my bad.
Hands grip.
You got to hold my hand a little bit more next time. Damn.
No. Hit Chris's grip. That was totally a who's on first situation.
Yeah, God damn.
No. His hand grip.
It's the
still
same
thing. Still the same.
Still the same. Left hand's lower, I believe. Did he talk to you about it? Was he switching it up?
No, I just was wondering because it's not it's not a mallet anymore. It's a blade.
Yeah, he still's got the same left hand lower.
So I didn't know if he's standing closer to it or if it still has an arc to it. I don't know.
He's got more of an arc and he just loves how he feels like he can just swing freer. Instead of he's like, I don't like all the lines, how long the mallet is. It just like messes me up. And I can also track my strike, which helps him as well.
Yeah, very cool.
So he liked that little change up.
Nice.
But, yeah, dude, after I proceeded to like just blast 1,000 golf balls out of bounds, I finally found my stride like on hole 6.
Right.
And by then the round's over, unfortunately.
Yeah, 9 holes is just not enough.
It's not enough.
Not enough golf.
Katie loves 9 holes. My goodness.
Madison loves 9 holes too.
It's not enough. Especially when you don't get any range time or anything like beforehand. You're just going out there and just playing 9. But I'm getting really sidetracked here because I don't want to take away from how beautiful this course is.
Right.
How well kept the course is.
Right.
For a 9-hole track and being in the canyon as well. Because it could sometimes get a little soupy, especially with all the rain that's been going on.
And Laguna Beach.
Yeah, dude. Like, it was firm. It was lightning fast.
Right.
And green as ever, all the way around the canyon. The whole course looked like it was in unbelievable conditions. There's water. There's tons of trouble. The bunkers are in great condition. It's just a truly great track. And I ended up playing really well in holes 6, 7, 8, 9. Hit a lot of good iron shots. Put all my longer clubs away except for the 9th hole because I had so much room on the 9th. It was wide open. But I hit a lot of good, really, really solid iron shots. Like, from 215 out on the par 3s.
Oh, that's
just
super hype for
just you. Like right online, but just I blasted it long.
Glad
just
to you.
Unfortunate. But like I hit it dead online, 5 iron. It was a great feeling. So
awesome, buddy. Glad you played well towards
maybe
the end.
Thanks, dude. It was a bummer as the scorecard was as rough as it was.
Right.
But yeah, dude. So For guys that have not checked out The Ranch, it is a fantastic track. And they also have great food over there, too.
It was supposed to be a full 18. That's why it's so nice. It's supposed to be a resort 18 holes, but Laguna Beach stopped the production of all 18 for wildlife.
Well,
reserves.
They did. Oh, that makes sense. That makes sense. They did dump a ton of cash, is what they look like in there. New carts, new clubhouse, new bar, outdoor seating.
Yeah, it's super cool.
Like, live band was there when we were like hanging out.
It's a vibe.
It is a really cool spot, and I honestly wanted to do a replay rate and see what that was going for.
It's not too bad. I think it's like, I don't know how much you pay for your tea time.
I think it was 60.
Yeah, I think it's 30.
Yeah, that's great.
Which is fun for that course. Like you said, it's super fun. So it sounds like you didn't really scare the hole, but I do have a big question for you. I'd love to get your opinion here on that.
What a segue. I did not scare any holes.
Yeah, it sounds like it. Did sound like you got
for a hole in one, dunking ones in. No, there was definitely none of that going on.
So is a hole in one a par three course an actual hole in one? The community seems a little divided in this sense. I will give my first take. I would say it doesn't matter what course it's on. It matters the yardage.
That's interesting. Does it have to be? 150? 120?
No. 100. I mean, maybe there's another one. I don't know of a PGA hole that's less than 100 yards. I don't think there's any. I would say like 105 to me.
Yeah, anything you're basically taking a close to a full swing at, right?
Yeah, 105 seems to me like a good number. I don't care what course it's on, but if it's a par three course and the distance like 105, I think that's fine. I just don't look at you as the same as a full 18, though. I don't know what it is.
Yeah, you want to hear my take?
Yeah.
If you get a hole in one, I'm going to upset a couple people if you do have these hole in ones. If you get a hole in one on a par three course or an executive style course, I don't think it's a true hole in one.
Yeah, I think that's where a lot of people would say.
I am counting it as a hole in one.
Yeah.
But I am not throwing it out there like, yeah, I have a hole in one.
It's like steroids with baseball. You should just do a little asterisk.
It's an asterisk. I give it an asterisk. Yep.
Right. It's
because in reality, you only have four par threes on a course, full size, full length.
That makes a lot of sense. There's more shots at it.
You get way more chances, and then you're not going from. You're not yanking driver out of your club or out of your bag. Like every single time you go to the tee box, there's more of a change up in the way you approach, the way you have to jump back and forth from your driver swing to putting to iron swing to chipping to driver. There's much more dynamic, club pulling in a full size course instead of a par three, par four course.
Okay.
That for me makes it more difficult. As well, because you can definitely find a groove of just hitting iron shot after iron shot after iron shot after iron shot a little bit more. You don't really have to change anything too much.
For sure. I think you're right there. But what I would say to you would be like, what about the Cradle, which is the par three course at
Bandon.
Yeah. I believe. Or it's Pinehurst. It's one of the two. Let's just say either of those par three courses.
Oh, man, dude.
Would you say you're at Pinehurst?
I'd flex that then.
For sure.
Yeah, well, I would 100%.
But you're playing Oso Creek, which is like another par three, par four course. That's not
I'm going to say it's a hole in one, but I'm not going to be like, let's say I have multiple hole in ones. I'm not putting that in the tally of like, ooh, I have three hole in ones.
It's a cool shot, though.
But two of them are, at Oso Creek. I would say I have like one and like a couple others.
I think that's a good take because it matters to me where at. If someone says, oh, I got a hole in one, and I'm like, oh, where at? Actually, the par three course at Pinehurst, like that would be all time.
That's for sure worth throwing out there.
But you say par three course.
Lake Forest?
Lake Forest. And I'm like, how many yards was it? And he's like 76.
You're like,
did you use your putter?
Yeah. Did you just take out a sand wedge and just pitch it? At that point, it's almost a pitch length.
Yeah, so I think to me it's yards. I would love to hear what some people think. I'm sure there'll be some messages about hole in one or not. But yeah, I don't know. I think it's yardage for me.
Overall.
Yeah.
Yeah, it does have to do with the yardage thing as well. You're kind of like bringing that into a little bit of a debate, and it's becoming relevant in this debate, I think, because a lot of par three courses and executive courses have holes that are, you know, 96 yards. Some of them are like 80.
I'd say 105 is a good distance.
But there's, yeah.
But speaking of hole-in-ones, someone did get one this weekend at Bay Hill.
Yeah.
And
it's pretty special.
Yeah. So, I mean, watching it, I unfortunately didn't get to view a lot of it.
Dude, it was a
end of it.
Fantastic tournament. Shout out Victor Hovland for that hole-in-one. Great. Super fun. Love what he's doing. But what an unbelievable tournament that was to watch. I watched a lot of it. Watched a lot of it on Saturday.
Mm-hmm.
Watched 6 hours of it on Sunday.
Oh,
I was locked in.
I love that shit. We were doing, I haven't done that in so long.
We were doing, I mean, there was two coverages, and the first coverage I was like in for like 2 hours, then I watched like the other like three and a half. It was
so great.
It was crazy. So I basically watched before the final pairing was teeing off. That's when I was tuning in.
So great, buddy.
A lot of golf.
What an awesome ending. I thought it was fun. I really wanted to see a playoff, I'm not going to lie.
I did too.
So I was hoping when he put it left into the shit, he would bogey.
What a shot Kurt Kitayama put on the 18th green.
That's a tournament winning shot right there.
Yeah, it is. Ice in his veins. They even said a stat. It was like 26% of the field hits the green from the left rough.
Right, that's crazy. And you're like, oh, this. You're like, there's no way he's doing it. And he puts an absolute beaut.
Hits a perfect shot to like 40 feet, as good as you can put it.
And it rolls an absolute gem.
To a quarter of an inch away from the hole.
Right.
I thought it was going in for a second.
I know, Madison and I were freaking out. She was watching it with me.
Yeah.
And she's like, what do you mean? He has to like, I'm like, yeah, he's got to mark it or like grab it, because then they'll if he waits too long, they'll stroke penalty him.
Yeah.
And then we got a playoff. But I thought it was an awesome putt. I saw memes like everyone could have made that putt for $3.8 million.
Yeah.
Like that's so funny. That's all time. It was a super cool story. I don't know if people knew or heard on the 18th green. It's called The Project.
Yeah.
I wanted to touch
on that.
I think it's great. I think
so sick.
Kurt, right?
Kurt Kitayama.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Displays in the Cabbage mindset was a project at UNLV. He played on, like, I saw a stat of how many, like, tours he played on.
Every professional tour you could imagine that's out there.
And just keeps grinding and just keeps swinging.
Yeah.
And, like,
he only came on the tour about two years. I think this is his third year. Yeah. And he's 30 now.
It's so cool to watch him succeed now and play well. I hope he does really well at this next tournament. What a cool story. He looked like
his interview after the round, he was getting a little choked up.
For sure. I mean, how do you not?
Just so emotional.
You
this man's
so
playing
hard
on every tour out there. You know, the Asian, DP, I mean, like, the list
Corn
just goes
Ferry.
On and on and on. Yeah. It's just crazy. He's played in, like, 9 different leagues or 8 different leagues. And, he seems like a very likable dude, a very humble person, and a guy that just really sticks his head down and just grinds and loves it because he just truly thinks that he can do it, one, but then it's just him putting in the work and reaping those rewards because he's been seeing a ton of benefit, obviously, clearly, recently, because he's now on the PGA Tour and a winner.
And won, you know, what, $8.3 million or $3.8?
A lot of money.
And that's just crazy.
$4 million.
It's just life-changing.
And he's got nicknames. He's called Quadzilla. Xander Schauffele gave him that nickname.
Yeah, isn't he like really good friends with Xander?
Yeah, really good friends with Xander. And also, The Project, I think, is really cool because he was basically a walk-on at UNLV, and he was, at the time, not very good at golf. But because he had such a great personality, his teammates actually rallied for him. Called him The Project, took him under their wing, and that's how he basically got kickstarted.
Cool.
And that nickname has stayed with him for this entire time. And I thought that was a really cool bit that they threw out there.
I wonder what, like, he was like, dude, I want a professional golfer. And he just has, it's just like a different level mentally these pro athletes have.
Yeah. Just what it takes now, especially in a game like golf. Especially in a game like
it's
golf
just a
now.
Different. I mean, you put me in that situation, into the Cabbage in the like left rough for the Ryder Cup, and I know what I do. I shit the bed. And I don't have millions of dollars on the line. And just even like going to UNLV, and he's like, I'm going to be a pro golfer. I don't care if I suck. I'm going to figure it out any way possible. Grinds for 15 years or whatever since he was 18. Who knows how long he's been at it? 15 years old maybe. And just started late and was like, yeah, I'm going to be a pro golfer. Like UNLV isn't like, from what I understand, an all-star golf program.
It's probably not. I know plenty of other colleges that are... you know, more prestigious, I guess.
I'm sure it's a good college golf school.
Yeah. I'm sure there's, I mean, and also, you also get a lot of late bloomers in golf as well. It just takes a lot of time to figure out you're going through a swing change.
I'm a late bloomer.
You're trying to, like, change your mechanics. I like to think we both are very late bloomers, and our best golf is...
just ahead of us.
Very near in the future, but way better golf. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what I keep telling myself.
I love that tournament. The greens looked like the grass was dead.
They were concrete, dude. Like, you might as well be rolling that thing on wood.
And if tour players are complaining about how hard it is and how people don't want to watch bogeys, you clearly have no idea what I want to watch in golf. I want to see you struggle.
Yes, dude. I want a birdie to actually mean something.
That's how golf is. I don't want to see you go out and shoot 12 under. I'm good. Like, I don't need that in my life. I don't need that like hit to my ego in my life. I want to see you struggle like I do on a par three course.
I want to see if you miss a fairway.
Right.
Like, you're in trouble already.
Right.
Like, you need to hit a miraculous second shot.
Like, also stop complaining about it at this point.
Everyone's playing the same course.
Right.
I mean,
it's hard. I get it, and I don't feel bad for you at all.
Life's not that difficult on the PGA Tour when you're a top player at a guaranteed money event.
You're playing a course that's really hard and somewhat unfair for you. Like, you're fine.
It's very entertaining though to watch them go from rough to rough or blast a ball out of bounds and they have to like re-tee and then they're in a bunker or something like that.
That's great.
Or they're leaving it in the bunker. They're putting it off the green. Like, it's something that's very relatable, and it just shows even the pros are having that much of a difficulty. And I even love it more because these elevated events, that you actually see all of the, well, you see a lot of good shots, but you see a lot of the bad shots at these elevated events because there's more TV coverage. They're covering a lot more people. And because the way the field was made up, because everyone was so jam-packed and tight, they were showing 15 different golfers the entire day instead of just focusing on the last pairing the whole day, which was fantastic. It was a scrap.
Yeah, it looked really fun. I really wish I got to fit more golf viewing in my life. It's just so I'm so busy. My calendar's already filled out all of March. It's crazy. Yeah. Super cool. We got the players coming up, but a couple other things I wanted to touch on here.
You want to go over our rankings and how we did this past week real quick for our picks?
Yeah,
or do you want to touch on something else?
I mean, real quick, let's touch on update on the new rules coming out of the PGA Tour. I didn't really know it fully, but it sounds like there's going to be more money in some of these tournaments. There's
do you know the final count? Is it 12 now?
Yeah.
Okay.
12, I think.
Compared to 8, I think it was.
I wish we had someone to Google it.
Yeah.
You know, it is what it is. We might be wrong.
It's something
like
that.
More. What was the name of the tournament?
Is it this year? Or is it, you're saying, is it?
Next year.
Oh.
Next year there will be more tournaments.
Got it. Okay.
What was the name of this tournament you called them again? They're not majors, second from a major.
Yeah, they're just like.
Elevated?
Yeah, they're elevated just elevated, or they're like, you know, they're mandatory tournaments for the top players to play in. So
totally.
Whatever word you want to put to that.
So that'll be fun. I think they're great rule changes. I don't know all of the details, like no cut fields, more money, all that stuff. I'm just always ride or die with whoever I love in golf and their opinion on it when I don't have an opinion myself. So I'm going to go with my man Max on this, and he thinks it's a good idea. And I think this guy understands what's good for golf right now. So I'm just going to ride my boy Max, to be honest.
Yeah, I do like it. My initial thought was that's not great because then it doesn't allow the rest of the field to compete. I do like it. I think it's fun, especially for the viewer, because then you're going to be getting more golf, more of the higher end players at these tournaments. You know they're going to show up, and they're going to be there, and it's better for the viewing. It's more competitive, and you know, I think Max and Roy like hit it pretty well. Like when Tiger and Phil were going out, you know, it was only one or two tournaments a year. You'd see like them kind of duke it out a little bit.
Right.
This way, now you're getting it 4, 5, 6 times a year.
I think it's great. And also, I imagine it's more money for the golfers, because instead of pitching the deal of maybe you're not always going to be at the field, so they can't guarantee you certain money. Maybe it's a per price deal. If you get to the full weekend, you get this amount. Half weekend, you get this amount. Now these golfers, I assume, could pitch a contract saying, I'm in the PGA Tour. I'm playing in all these 12 exclusive events, which means you're advertising. I'm a top 15 player. I'm going to be on TV more than anyone else, which means your advertising dollars need to go up too.
Sure.
And I think it's just a good move for the PGA Tour, once again, changing because of LIV and what they're doing. And if LIV people are like, well, you know, that's why LIV is better, yada, 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 suck it, it's business. That's what happens. You did something cool, LIV. That's awesome. Really happy you've changed the PGA Tour for the better. If that was your goal, great job, Phil. If your goal was to make the PGA Tour better,
yeah.
You did it. You did it successfully. But if people are complaining like, oh, they're just copying LIV, like, of course they are. It's either adapt or die. And nowadays,
it's a business. At the end of the day, it is a paycheck. And if they're making these events over on LIV and everyone's getting paid and they just show up and they get a paycheck, you know, that's certainly a major factor for, I mean, it's their job. It's a great job. Mind you that, but it's still their job. Like, they're not going out there and they are playing for fun and to compete, but it's also the paycheck that they're getting. So, you know, that's one of those things where if they don't add that, that's always going to be in the back of their mind saying, oh, I could just go sign at LIV. And if I'm having some down years, you know, then I just get paid.
Right. I think it's great by the PGA Tour. Thank you, LIV. All that LIV stuff too. I'm really fresh with all these wounds as well because of the swing doc. We finished that up, you and I. And I thought it finished great. The last two episodes finished really well. To me, it's still nowhere close to Drive to Survive. I finished Drive to Survive in 2 days. The swing doc I finished over a course of like 2 weeks.
Yeah. Partly because we were watching it together for the most part. And I will have to say, though, I am in agreeance with you. However, there was a few really heavy hitting episodes, and we kind of jumped the gun, I feel like, a little bit on the full swing, because we had the Sahith Tagala and Mito Pereira episode,
which now I'm a huge Mito fan, but I'm really bummed that, of course, he went to LIV. But I don't think we jumped the gun. I don't think it's as good as Drive to Survive. Even the Rory episode, I didn't see enough golf, and there also wasn't like an updated tournament list. And Drive to Survive, even though it's so much about the politics of it, you're watching a full race most of the time.
Yeah, that's true. And they follow you through, and then they bring the storyline always with it. The battle for fourth, the battle for third, what's going on with the driver decisions and politics and overspending that Red Bull had to deal with. We're getting a little bit off track because we're keeping it on full swing. But I agree with you that there needs to be more of that, more golf, more storyline, less just casual viewing is what it feels. It just felt like a lot of casual viewing.
Maybe season one, they're trying to introduce people to golf.
Yeah. You know, Drive to Survive is in its fifth season as well.
Yeah, I just wish it was a bit more, for me, a bit more like Drive to Survive, which it's not. But it was so good. The Rory episode and the Sahith was so awesome. Just why I love golf was both those episodes. Like, watch those guys. You don't get that on LIV, that, like, passion of winning, of what that feels like right now. That's not on LIV.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's great, buddy. And, would you overall think about it?
I mean, it was overall good. Again, I'm going to take it with a little bit of a grain of salt. It's season one. I was partly because I was so hyped for it. Maybe that's what it kind of, it didn't, I wasn't enthralled by it because of just
what a great word,
all of the hype that I was surrounding it. And I kind of gassed myself a little bit up too for it. Overall, I thought it was good. I think they're gonna only gonna improve on it. So I'm just gonna leave it at that.
I think overall good as well. But I do think it needs improvement.
Mm-hmm.
So we're gonna move into our little bit of our segment here of our podcast, buddy. We did do some betting, as you guys heard, on the Arnold Palmer. We'll give the updates on that, buddy. Why don't you lead into what we got going on here?
Quick run downhill here. You guys know the rules. We get to pick 1 through 15 for the MGM odds for the tournament, 16 through 40th, 40th through the rest of the field. The winner from the previous week gets the pick in each category first. Then the other person gets to follow suit. And then you take the average of all of those finishes. And so you had, and I'm already forgetting your picks, dude.
It's okay. I got you here, buddy.
What were your picks for for Bay Hill?
Bay Hill. I didn't write those down, but that's fine. Bay Hill, I had Nick Taylor, who was cut. I had Shane Lowry,
yeah,
who got T64, and I had Scottie Scheffler top four.
Yeah, that's great for Scottie. The rest of the field, not that great. I had a little bit of a slip up the prior week,
yeah.
So we kind of level each other out now. We're now tied up, essentially.
Oh, yeah.
I'm averaging 30th for my picks. You're averaging 29th, so we got a tight one, and I picked a banger of a week, and I needed that badly.
Big week come for you, buddy.
I grabbed Harris Inglis from the rest of the field, and he finished T2. I got Jordan Spieth, and he was T4 or T2. And then I had Tony Finau, which was like 26 or something like that.
Yeah, you go ahead and just rub that in my face. I, you know,
you were trying to gloss over it and look forward to the players here. Now looking ahead, because that I got the overall average better finish than you.
Kicking my butt.
Yeah, we can now roll this into our picks for this week. And again, this is for you guys as well. Like, we're doing this for us, and it's going to be our fun little friendly wager. But again, feel free to play along with us if you want to make a couple sports bets. These are guys that we think that could finish in the top, you know, I don't want to be too bold here, but certainly our top, our upper echelon pick in the top 10.
Yeah, we're hoping there's two picks on here that win, and we're hoping the last ones do well.
Right, exactly.
The first two picks we have in the draft, we hope probably have a shot at winning. The last picks are guys we're hoping top 25, top 30 be amazing.
Exactly. So I kicked us off here with a guy that I believe is going to get his first PGA Tour win. Maybe not at this event, but it's going to happen this year. Dude is an absolute stud. Bombs it off the tee. He has these little bit of mental blips every once in a while, but I do think that it's going to be like a potential Scottie Scheffler type player in the next couple years. If he can hone in a couple of things in his game, and that's Cameron Young for me.
Love that pick.
Cameron Young is a guy that he lives in the 188 ball speed.
That's so fast.
Comfortably.
So fast.
Just nukes it down there. It's unbelievable. And he can hit it both ways. And he just takes dead aim with his irons. And he's a pretty aggressive player. He just needs to learn how to figure out his putting a little bit. Every once in a while, that kind of leaves him. Sometimes gets a little bit erratic. But, I mean, he's 25 years old. Won rookie of the year last year on the PGA Tour. Little bit of a stretch because there were plenty of big names on the board. But I don't know. I wanted to shout out Cameron Young because he's playing great and he finished at a pretty good position over at Bay Hill last weekend.
I think it's a great pick, buddy. We also try not to repeat picks from the last two tournaments as well.
Point, bud.
I mean, if we could pick the top player every time to win, we pick Rom, but there's no money in that. So we like to pick who we think might have a shot at this and still may win you some money or win us some money.
Yeah.
But I picked, after you, someone who...
He's your ride or die, bud.
Yeah, always top 15 or top 20 finish right now. Awesome guy. I'm going to go Max Homa. Haven't picked him yet. I'm really, really excited to cheer for him this weekend. I think it's a tournament that requires a bit more control in your game. And I feel like Max is in a good position to really capitalize on that. Rest of the field maybe being a little bit more wild.
That's a great pick, dude.
Yeah.
I feel like the way he's playing, he's never finishing outside of the top 30.
It's so much fun to watch him play and just talk. I'm a huge Max Homa fanboy right now.
Love that pick, buddy.
Let's hear your second one here, bud.
Yeah, and then I went back for their 16th through 40th. I went with a guy that's another young buck. Again, I don't think he wins enough. Again, it's one of those guys I think could win more, and I don't know why, where his breakdowns are in his game that much. And it's Sung Jae Im. He's a young buck, and he's rock solid, and he feels like he's another guy that can be a little bit too aggressive and get himself in trouble at times.
Right.
But my goodness, can that man throw some darts at the pin?
Yeah, when he gets going, it's really just starts cooking.
He just cooks up these like 2-yard fades that just never waver, and they just could be a tuck. It's just a tuck pin, and he's still taking dead aim. And when he's on, you know, that man can shoot 65 really easily.
Love that.
Makes the game look easy.
My second pick here, a guy I think is going to win a tournament soon. Been loving watching his content. He's been putting out with Bob Does Sports is Keegan Bradley.
Just a big personality and a guy you really want to get behind.
Yeah, I'm a big personality guy if you haven't figured that out. I think looks like he's in a spot right now where he's playing really, really, really good golf.
Mm-hmm.
And his game, when it's on, doesn't waver, really. It's very much down the middle drive, onto the green, two putt, next hole.
Yeah.
And to me, that's some awesome golf. Third pick, buddy,
And you need that, too, at this course. I mean,
you really do.
Exactly.
It's really tight and crazy. It's a peat dye design. It's water everywhere. It's meant to be the hardest course on tour, is why he designed it. And so it's going to be tough. And so we're hoping to find some people that can
battle through the Cabbage a little bit.
Right. Fight through it.
My last pick here. This is a guy that has really, I wouldn't say fallen off, but has fallen off where he wants to play the game. And a lot of that was because due to injury. He's been battling a lot with like his hip, his knee. But I really think that he's on the up and up a little bit here. It looks like he's getting finally healthy and is playing some decent golf for him, for his standards. And a guy that I always liked watching is Gary Woodland.
Yeah, I love Gary. When he's ever in the top 10 or top 15, I always cheer for him.
Not a very big personality guy, but just looks like he's just an athlete out there.
Yeah, it looks like he hates every minute of it, but it's just so good.
He's locked
in. But like a lovable way.
He has fun, though, because he in a very level way. It looks like he has fun on the course with his shot shaping, though, I will have to say.
Yeah.
He loves moving the ball around, hits a ton of stingers. And the reason why I grabbed him is because he can control his trajectory on his ball flight really well.
Which can help a lot.
And you really need that on the island green. Got to have it.
Yeah, island green's so much fun.
Man. Yeah, dude.
Someone's complaining about, real quick, little segment. Last year, there was more balls put in the water than I think in history, I'm pretty sure, in the last tournament.
Really?
It was because of the way the wind was coming in. And they say when that wind's coming in a certain way, which I think is from the front left edge to the back right edge.
It also like comes over the grandstands funky, too. Right. So if you hit it too high, then it really messes with your ball
flight. So they say that the wind on this hole makes it, you know, impossible. It's just luck of the timing because in general it's not that tough of a shot. So they're talking about having a bailout area built in the back side of it.
Really?
And I think that's just an awful, awful decision. Again, make it smaller. Put more bunkers.
Yeah, I don't love that idea.
Make it longer. Like, I don't want you to have an easier shot at this. And my third pick is a man who always just seems to find it in big moments for me. Smooth, always loves a paycheck in top 20th. It's Kevin Kiz. Big, smooth for me, or little smooth, while I call him, instead of big smooth. Again, big personality.
I love that pick, dude. I mean, he played well here last year, and he's a grinder. I think this course, again, fits the way your picks are, you know, that you're making your picks here.
You can tell I'm going with guys who, when their game is on, there's not much to it. I think with peat dog horses, you need to have some good control over irons and driver and your game. I think when you start getting wild is when it gets more difficult. But, yeah, buddy, we'll see how we do this weekend. I'm really liking your board. I'm really liking my board. I think we really got a great shot at doing well.
Yeah.
I am one spot ahead of you currently. It seems
one spot. It's a tight race here, and it's a long race. So,
tight, long race.
Looking for a little bit of a heated battle. I think it's going to be great. It's going to be a fun tournament to watch. I was trying to find a statistic that I read on Instagram, and it was a post, and I was trying to see if it was Golf Digest or Scratch. I've struck out on both of those really quickly, and now I'm not going for a third, which was probably going to be like the PGA Tour. However, it was really fun because you were touching on the 17th hole, how small it was, right?
Right.
And how everyone was like, it's the most difficult. They need to make a little bailout area. And just to kind of just put it in, you know, a little bit of the
perspective,
like,
of it.
Yeah, exactly, like how difficult it is,
right?
And like they had amateurs play it,
right?
Here it is, dude. Here it is. It's on the PGA Tour. The pros make it look easy. It's not. 95 amateurs play the stadium course at TPC Sawgrass, and it's just crazy watching all of these shots. 56% of the shots found the water. Every group had at least one in the water, and 10 players hit three or more in the water. 57 out of 95 made double or worse.
Yeah, it's a hard hole. Like, it's definitely a hard hole. Make it smaller.
So we talked and touched about earlier how we want to see golfers struggle out there, and this is exactly the course. This is exactly the reason why. It's fun to watch them because I'm going out there, and I'm having a really tough time.
I'm panicking on 17.
Yeah, I'm panicking.
If I'm coming in with a round into 17, which I would never would on that course.
If you're going to, you have the opportunity to break 90 or 95 there.
Right. And
in
I'm
your,
coming
in your
into
game,
17, I'm worried that it's all going to shit.
You could
real
easily
fast.
You could easily card a 12 there.
Right. And knowing me, I probably wouldn't take the drop the first shot either because I would want to put it on the island green.
Mm-hmm. Of course, you're not gonna go back there every single summer.
No, so I'm gonna just keep whacking balls until it's on the green.
Mm-hmm.
Great, buddy. We'll have to round that out. Let you guys know how it goes next podcast. But around this podcast out, we're gonna continue a segment we did last week, which is the three worst list. Today's topic is on breakfast menu items.
This is gonna be very controversial.
I mean, everyone's gonna hate my picks.
I'm going to get a lot of heat for my picks, too. But, yeah, you know, there's a lot of solid breakfast items out there. But then there are just three in my eyes that just really...
You'll never touch.
I'm never going towards.
Right,
exactly.
You have to. Like, for whatever reason. It's like what they make is a specialty or something.
I guess. But these are not specialty items here. These are just your... For me, just very plain Jane items.
Right. We're not doing fruit, sourdough toast, whole wheat toast.
Yes,
these are
exactly
menu items.
Yeah. Full-on entrees here.
Full-on entrees. All right, buddy. Do you want to lead us off here?
I will.
Give us your top three or your worst three, and then I'll give you my worst.
Going in my number three here. This is an entree. Again, I think that a lot of it has to do with the fact when we go to restaurants, we want to go and buy or get something that's difficult to make. Like, we both cook.
Right.
And this is something that, for me, I can easily whip up, but I am not making this because it's just something that doesn't intrigue me. I'm never going to it. I'm never going to order at a restaurant for, one, the taste, but then, two, how easy it is to make.
Yeah.
It just really has nothing going for it for me. Nothing wrong with it, but it's not something I'm gravitating towards, never ordering it. And that's just the American breakfast.
You know, that's such a great pick. Like a two egg over easy, two sausage, two bacons, and some toast.
Not doing it for me.
Yeah, that's my grandma's favorite. She wants two eggs over easy. She wants to put a mound of salt on it.
There is nothing
that
I get up for on that.
Yeah, she loves it. Two runny eggs.
Just white bread.
Home fries. She always asks, what's the home fries? You know, Love that.
So yeah, that's my number three. It just,
I think it's awesome.
It's nothing I'm ever going
towards. I'm never ever picking a classic breakfast.
No, never.
Whatever they call it, the home right. style breakfast, or who cares?
Exactly.
All right, buddy.
So continue on for me?
No, yeah, let's finish okay. up your whole list.
This is something I'm never touching again. Now we're getting into the nitty gritty here.
Yeah, now we're like,
because I have two big bugaboo items.
Yeah.
My two, and this is very controversial. This could be bracketed into a section of three items, I would say,
okay.
that you can potentially have. And this for me is the lowest of those three, obviously, clearly. And that for me is the pancake. The other two, waffle and French toast, in that pecking order of French toast being at number one, and then waffle coming in number two, but number three is pancake.
Mass and I went to brunch this morning, and we got a pancake sampler.
Do not like pancakes. I don't get it.
Awful take.
I don't really love syrup. I don't love it. It makes it super soggy. They're really filling, and I don't like the cakey taste. I don't really like that. It's not anything I'm gravitating toward. It's not great. And I never want to eat a full meal of pancakes.
Yeah, I get that.
Now, if I'm going and
they're always like manhole covers, too. Why are they always so big?
They're massive. Like, what are we doing? These things are like basically an inch thick, like it's a school book.
Right. Use them as shields.
There's like a 2-inch overhang over the plate. Dude.
Yeah,
it's absurd.
Not, too much pancake.
You got syrup just going all over the place, dude.
Yeah, it's all sticky.
Yeah, my number one. I don't know if you saw this coming, but I bet you would if you gave it some more thought. And this has no business being an entree item in my eyes. This is the furthest thing from a full meal. It's a donut.
Oh my God. I would have, you know what?
When people come to breakfast and they're like, hey, I brought donuts. You bet your ass. I am skipping out on those donuts and not eating in the morning. I'm skipping. I'm literally, that is the only thing that they bring.
Uh-huh.
I am not eating a donut.
Katie loves donuts.
Loves them.
I cannot
stand
donuts anymore.
I cannot stand them. Cannot stand them.
I don't know if that's a breakfast menu item.
It's debatable. You could throw the flag here. You could throw a little warning here, but
we're going to review it. Your feet are in, but you're touching the line. You're
close. However, that is not really restaurant ordering, mm-hmm. but people will bring donuts and donuts only to breakfast.
I would love if someone, you brought donuts to breakfast? Love it.
Your family used to do that, and I thought you guys were crazy.
Donuts to breakfast are the best. You don't like donuts?
No.
It's crazy. You
want nothing to do with them.
It's awful.
Maybe I will have half of a jelly-filled donut.
The worst donut, dude.
Those were the only ones that I liked.
Donut.
Jelly-filled donuts are
you
the only...
You good donut. Sidecar?
Dude.
Oh, my God. Okay.
Eh.
You just.
I just don't
joy.
Like donuts.
No, you just hate joy.
I will have to say I had a cream cheese donut, and
yeah.
that was far. It's not even really a donut at that point. It's because
right.
it's so savory, which is why I loved it. This is totally. I'm now just taking a really low jab at this branch, wildly successful company. It's Krispy Kreme, and those can just go straight down
the hot
garbage.
Freshes.
Straight down the garbage
oh
disposal.
My God,
I don't even want to bite. I don't
that's
even
so,
want to bite.
That's so bad.
They're awful.
Bad
awful.
Take. All right. Well, I respect
sure.
it.
I'm about ready to roast your list right now.
Yeah, my list is awful. What do I even eat? Breakfast is what my list is. But I think my list is for people out there who is a average American. You know, I feel like I'm talking to the people. Who
Tommy's
really,
a man of the people for breakfast items.
I am
okay?
a man of the people. And bringing up my... you're going to hate my list.
I know it is.
You're
going to
hate my
because you despise
list.
My pick. You despise my list.
The third item, which I will grab if there's nothing else on the menu.
Okay.
Or they specialize in it.
Okay.
Would be an omelet.
Yep, I knew that was coming. I thought omelet was going to be two, actually.
No, because... You can have a good omelet. with some potatoes, you can cut it up, make a little like hash out of it. I'm a big hash guy.
I was just about to say, why not just make omelet? Almost made my list, by the way. And then I thought, let's sneak in the donut.
Yeah, if someone wants like a goat cheese and spinach omelet, like what are we doing?
Oh, I love goat
egg
cheese.
White omelet. Like what are we doing here? Like, I don't need any of that. I'm not going to breakfast for the health.
Very true.
I'm not going to breakfast. I'm not going to breakfast. Like, oh, I'm gonna make sure I eat something healthy here.
Most time when you go out for breakfast as well, you're going for brunch.
Right.
And when you're going for brunch, you are not going for healthy because it's the weekend. You're hanging out. You're having a couple of drinks. Give me the fucking biscuits and gravy on the side, please. Like, you know,
I'm not.
Can I swap out my potatoes for gravy and biscuits here?
Right. I want the frittata, or I want the, you know. Whatever.
I love it. That's a great pick because it's really easy to mess up an omelet and it's really difficult to make it exceptional.
Yeah. Omelet bars suck too. I don't care what you say.
Overrated. If I'm going for health, I'm hitting up that omelet bar 10 times out of 10.
And also, you see, like, when someone makes a really good omelet, the work it takes to make a good omelet is never
a lot of work.
An omelet bar. Number two for
me.
That's
a great take. I love that three pick by you. Okay.
Number two for me, I won't touch unless it's homemade and it has to have so much shit in it for me to eat it that it's basically not even what it is anymore is a quiche.
Okay.
I do not like quiches.
Okay.
At all. It has to have so much stuff in the quiche for me to make it. It's got to have peppers and bacon and cheese and salsa. And, like, it's not even a quiche anymore. I'll never touch it.
It's essentially a scramble, but it's just baked instead. And it's got a pie crust on it. And sometimes the pie crust is not executed very well. It's a little soggy down there. It doesn't bring anything to the table. Again, If not properly executed and done to your liking, I could totally see.
I'm a huge snob.
I could totally see why you can just push that to the side, and I'm not disagreeing with you whatsoever. I will have to say, though, if you get a good quiche, pretty dynamite.
Yeah, I haven't had a good quiche. That's why I would say they're not dynamite. Mm-hmm. I'm an egg snob in the idea of not because I know what good eggs are. I'm just not a huge fan of eggs.
Yeah. Yeah.
So like Egg Slut, which is a famous egg sandwich place, do their egg scrambles really soft.
You don't love that?
Not
you don't like the French style?
No, I like my eggs over medium, runny yolk, mixed in with a bunch of their stuff so I can hide the egg. I like the yolk of an egg, but I don't like the texture of eating an egg. It's very strange. My number one.
You like the runniness of the yolk though?
For sure.
So here's another follow-up question. When you cook eggs, or do you ever cook eggs?
Very rarely.
Okay. When I do fried rice, and I do that over easy egg, and I just sear the hell out of it on the bottom so it's crispy and
so
kind of craggly.
You're doing like sunny side up, essentially.
Yeah, no, I'm doing over easy because I'm flipping it, but I'm cooking it 90% of the way through from the bottom up, and then I'm just flipping it over, and I'm turn off the heat before I flip it over.
Right.
So it kisses it, and then like it makes that runny yolk. But so it's super crunchy, but then you still get that velvety texture.
I like the egg in the fried rice, but there are times for me where I'm
like,
do without it.
Okay, got it.
But it's not because I want the yolk. So I will always do it for the yolk.
Got it.
But I won't do it just because I love egg.
Yeah, got
it. Where, like, people are, like, egg culture, like, three eggs on top of their fried rice and they're in heaven. I just can't do it.
I love it.
I know. number one, the item I won't ever touch, which is just an abomination to all cuisine. My wife will hate me for this, is any seafood Benedict, I'm out. Like a salmon Benedict,
a
lobster Benedict.
Shot out of left. I did not see this coming.
Shrimp Benedict. Anything with seafood and hollandaise.
Okay.
And a English muffin or your corn biscuit or whatever bullshit you want to put underneath that lobster isn't getting me to get it. And it's also $32. I'm never touching a seafood Benedict.
I was going to say, I don't know if I've even had a seafood Benedict.
Wifey does. And she loves them. She loves a good seafood Benedict. I won't touch it. It's the most. It's like having like steak at a breakfast restaurant. Why would I ever trust this breakfast from a guy back there who
isn't?
That's
a great point. That's
touching
a great point.
Any ocean near us, making me a lobster Benedict. I am out.
That's a good point.
I can't do it.
A lot of the higher end seafoods, arguably they do go well with the hollandaise sauce. You know, I just don't know if I'm ready for that for breakfast either. Again,
yeah, it's so
give me
decadent.
Some ham, give me some turkey sausage, give me some regular sausage, give me some bacon.
Yeah,
good with all of that.
I don't need lobster, corn potato, you know, bread for the bottom, yeah. And a smoky, peppery hollandaise on top. I'm out.
Mm.
That rounds up my top three. Buddy.
I did not see that one coming.
What do you think was
do love
one?
The picks? I don't know. I thought you were going to just keep on the egg train and just go frittata.
Frittatas are okay. Frittatas and quiche are the same thing to me.
Yeah.
I thought pancake was going to be your number one.
Once I thought of donut, that was going to be...
Yeah, you never touched donuts.
If you're going to throw the flag and hypothetical here, I would have pushed donut out, obviously. That would have been the, you know, I was out of bounds, mm-hmm. illegal catch, no catch, whatever.
Yeah, what would you be at 1-2?
I end up sliding in the omelet to number three. Yeah. If I'm just talking about me enjoying a meal, omelet number three, American breakfast number two, pancake number one.
The American breakfast was going to make it because I never would just eat egg by itself. But I put that on toast with a little jam, and it's okay.
Again.
That's, to me,
again,
fine.
Not going anywhere near it.
Right. I get that. why don't you tell me your favorite breakfast menu item? Something you always see on the menu, and you're like, 100%, that's it, and I'm
out. Got two that I always got to get, and I look at. Number one, this should be no surprise to you. It's an Eggs Benedict.
Yeah, Eggs Benedict is great. If it had, especially if they do like specialty good. Ones, I'm really in for.
And like, you know, it's a place that they do. I'm just a sucker for hollandaise, dude.
Yeah, you really
I
like
love hollandaise.
Sauce.
I mean, it's egg yolks
on top
butter,
of the egg, yeah.
and lemon.
Yeah,
on
it's
top
really
of it, on top of a runny yolk.
Yeah,
like
I get it.
Poached egg. I love a poached egg. I never poach eggs, and again, that's just another thing that I will never do when I'm at home.
Yeah.
I'm just not going to make a hollandaise at home. Way too fickle, way too much work. You know, it's just, it's one of those things
too
I'm
much.
Not touching. But like a restaurant does them well, you know, it's like, damn, this is really hitting with some potatoes as well.
Mm-hmm.
That's my like number one go-to. And then anything with like a salsa verde type setting. So like a...
Chilaquiles.
Chilaquiles is big and up there. Some like
green chili pork burrito.
Exactly.
I got
that
you.
That kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And then like I guess just for like my everyday mm-hmm. is breakfast burrito.
Yeah. Every day breakfast burrito is up there for me. I won't get it at a restaurant really because I'm like I'm here to do something different.
Exactly.
If I'm at a place that does breakfast burritos, I'm hyped. I will go to a place for breakfast burritos.
Yes. But if you're doing a sit down brunch, you're not going to order the breakfast burrito. You're going to get
like scramble.
Really?
Yeah.
You're love going scrambles.
Love scrambles.
Interesting.
Not hash or hash of some sort.
Yeah, yeah. With like potato driven, right?
Yeah, potato.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's always got potatoes on it.
You can do like a Mexican hash with it's got chorizos, onions, bell peppers.
Yeah, potatoes. I get that with toast or tortilla.
Yeah, for sure. Like a machaca.
I've never had machaca before.
You never had a machaca before, dude? It's on a lot of menus.
I have to check out machacas.
You would like it. It's the maybe I'm out of terms here, but I'm assuming it's like basically like a Mexican like hash, like a style on that.
Yeah.
So a lot of like chili powder and bell peppers and onions with potatoes like on that comes on the side, but it's primarily egg, but you can just throw everything together and they serve it with salsa.
Is scramble the right word for it, what I'm thinking of?
Yeah. Yeah, it's like an egg scramble.
Yeah, but like the egg's like never scrambled within it. It's always on top of it. It's always like over medium eggs on top of like a potato meat.
That's
hash.
I think it's a version of that, I'm assuming.
Yeah, I forget the name of it. But yeah, buddy. Hell of a podcast, bud. Again, rounding it out here.
Yeah, we're running it.
You know, catch us on, you know, we're trying to get the episodes more dialed in, so we'll have an easier release date for you guys. That's a bit more you know, figuring it out.
Well, we want to go through and for you guys to, you know, follow along with our picks. And if you guys are watching the tournaments that we're doing this for, obviously I'm talking about the PGA Tour. We want you guys to listen in, check it out, follow along with us. And if you do like our bets, great. hop on board.
Right.
Be perfect. Part of the team. Go for it.
So we're hoping to get that a bit more dialed in. Of course, it's extremely difficult and we don't have the bandwidth or, you know, we have to have a lot of help. And
exactly.
People are willing to help us, which is great. So bear with us as we try to figure out how to make this a bit more consistent. And then video, once I figure out how to edit that, will be great for us. But our boys will always be, you know, at some point in the description of our podcast, it'll be, you know, Madison, John, and Jake always helping us out. Thank you to all of you, truly, John especially, working very hard for us on this. And Jake always sending the awesome thumbnails, and Madison doing social. You got anything for us, buddy?
Boom, baby, dude. Shout outs. You just rolling through those. Those were nice. I don't have anything to close this up. It was a hell of an episode. I feel like I can keep talking about food for you for a with you for a while.
We love food.
Seems to always be a hot topic. Really jealous you just went down there and grabbed some more barbecue at Heritage, dude.
Yeah, you should be upset.
Yeah, I'm a little upset you haven't like dragged me there.
I have
by
some
now.
Brisket in there. I saved you.
And that's going to do it for tonight's episode, folks.
You know, like, comment, subscribe. We're not going away. We're going to be here for a while, so get used to us. We're in the cabbage. And just a reminder, keep swinging. In the cabbage.